Beaver. This is not good.
Uh-oh.
He says, tell Bo. Spot on. He's telling it just right, like it is. More people need to be like that.
Like Bo Dietl.
Oh, man.
Uh-oh.
See, I'm not going to be able to escape it.
That's right.
So if you got Bo Dietl and Joe Beaver together, that would just not be dangerous.
Yeah, man. That's America right there.
So here's what I'm wondering. If you beat yourself up.
Right.
And then call the police, can you file charges? Can you sue yourself?
You sue yourself.
That's kind of so bad. Anyway, well, I get these, Kevin McGee, our boss, who is a great boss, by the way. I'm not, isn't he?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But he sends me funny stuff all
the time.
So. And he sent me something about some rap star beating somebody else. I don't know what the hell it was. So.
Oh, okay.
Hey, Warner.
Yes.
I see the New York Post got big front page. Dan Marino got a love child.
Hmm. Yeah, 7 years old. Yeah.
Why is... who ratted him out? Boomer?
No. Quarterbacks stick together.
Okay.
Yeah, sure.
No. Well, that's the way
it is.
They're
broadcasters now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure that's something they won't address during the CBS telecast, the pregame show.
Well, why did it just come out now?
I don't know. But it is interesting that it's a couple days before the biggest audience they'll have.
Yeah.
One never knows, do one.
It's a New York Post page 6 exclusive.
There you go. Wow.
Well, it looks to me like isn't it on the front page of the paper?
Yes.
It certainly is, yeah.
It's the page 6 team that put it together, though, I guess.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, who's squeakier or cleaner than Dan Marino?
Uh-huh. Well, me, for one.
There you go.
Right or now. Me.
Yeah, me.
Well, back when he was, you remember back when he was drafted in 83?
Yeah. Yes.
There were some rumors there. Remember that, Warner?
Yes, about smoking marijuana.
Yeah.
If it was going to discourage somebody from drafting him.
And some cocaine rumors, too.
Yeah. So. Oh, at Pitt. He played at
Pitt. That's right.
But the Dolphins took him, so.
Yeah.
And good thing they did. One of the great quarterbacks ever, right?
Yes. He was until Favre and Peyton Manning passed him. He had all the records.
Right.
But not a rocket scientist, clearly.
No.
No, you can watch the show, that show, which I've seen occasionally. They're all nice guys, but there's nobody there going to the Mensa meeting.
No.
Mm.
Well.
But that's fine.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
So, well, what do we know about the love child?
Well, the young woman, he met her at CBS.
Oh, and, sure.
The young woman is married.
Oh, darn.
There's another child.
She wasn't married at the time.
No.
She has since married.
Right.
She was 35 at the time. She was a production assistant at CBS.
Right.
And he has a wife and 6 kids.
Carly, are you hearing this?
I am hearing this.
Okay.
So. 6 kids.
Yeah. And then she, after he paid her the millions, she became a fixture, according to page 6, this guy Ian Moore, a fixture on the Upper West Side, your hood, Chief.
Yeah.
And the Hamptons.
Oh.
She came a fixture on the social scene, he says.
So he took care of him.
You mean with Marino?
No.
Nope. On her own. She got some shekels from my boy, and she started living large. And this is the way the guy writes it. You can tell he's a page 6 writer.
Mm-hmm.
He writes, the ex-Miami Dolphin quarterback knocked up Donna Savateri, a then 35-year-old production assistant at CBS Sports Manhattan Studio.
Well written.
Well, that's...
It is.
So, Carla, you let us know if somebody's fooling around here, right?
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks for looking out, Iman. Thanks for looking out.
Yeah. Well, that's just insane, isn't it? Well, poor guy.
I'm not a poor guy, but... I don't know if it's insane.
Well, how many millions of dollars did he give the girl?
Well, we don't know.
Doesn't say.
Any other Super Bowl news?
No mention of Mark Duper or Mark Clayton.
Well,
I kind of knocked Ray Lewis. Oh, guess what I ordered yesterday, Warner?
Oh, wow.
I ordered the deer antler spray.
Oh, man.
Of course.
And I tried to get it overnight, and they won't send it to you overnight for some reason.
Oh.
I even called them. Megan called them.
Yeah.
So they mail it to you, whatever. So.
How much is it, by the way?
A couple hundred bucks.
Huh.
For... How much did you get?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know, a little spray bottle of it.
Oh, and that's a couple hundred bucks, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. This tie-in.
I just got that stuff in it, that IFD, whatever the hell it is.
Yeah.
IGF, right?
Yeah, it's got that in it. So.
Yes.
That explains why Ray Lewis eating grass.
Yeah.
I have, according to Dr. Bronson, Michael Bronson, because, by the way, you never need to be operated for anything. Joint replacement thing. He's a great surgeon. God, man.
Mm-hmm.
So I have a pinched nerve in my shoulder
that's
absolutely killing me. And, I mean, killing me. I wasn't even going to come to work today. It hurts so bad. So he said, well, you have to take a 5 or 6 day course of steroids was the way to treat that. Well, I just got off steroids.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, so I haven't been on steroids a couple months now. But I'm supposed to have some, I know there's a lot of information, but I'm going to reach a point here.
Mm-hmm.
I have to have some blood work done with Dr. Katz on Friday. You know, they check me every once in a while for this prostate cancer.
Right.
See what all of my values are, and my CR protein, my inflammation, white blood count, all that. So I asked Dr. Katz, I say, do you think my taking the steroids will affect the blood test? He says, no, I don't think so. But Deidre does.
Okay.
Now, Deidre is not a doctor. She's insane. So he said, well, then you take it and wait a couple weeks and then come in for the. But now it began. Here's what I've decided to do.
Okay.
To avoid everything, I'm going to suffer through today. What is today? Thursday?
Yeah, today's Thursday.
Today and tomorrow morning.
Okay.
And I get the blood test around 10:30, something like that.
Yeah, you don't want to deal with it at all. I don't blame you.
Because if I take the steroids, and let's say the white inflammation is up or whatever,
mm-hmm.
you'd never hear the end. I'd rather suffer.
Yep.
I'd rather be in abject agony.
Wow. Told you so, all that.
God almighty. And she's been right about a lot of stuff, so.
Good track record.
Yeah.
So I, you know.
And you got the Super Bowl. No, you don't need that.
And then Wyatt is such an evil child.
What?
He's evil.
No.
He chimes in with her, and he said, well, let me ask you something.
Yeah.
And I said, yeah. He said, when you take the steroids, now you start with this protocol, it's 5 or 6 days. First day, you take 24 milligrams of Medrol, which is a lot. Wyatt says, Do you feel it at all? Does it? I said, yeah. If you haven't been on steroids for a while, it makes you feel great. So, he said, well, then this obviously would have some effect on your. I said, he can rope calves,
right?
And steers, but he doesn't know anything about this.
No. You're taking the safe road here. I think it's the right thing to do.
I feel a little bit better now. I took some Advil, or the hell it is.
But. All right.
I know you don't want to hear about this, and I'm sorry to burden you with it.
This is stoicism on display,
right,
folks. Iman's going to suffer so he doesn't have to suffer more.
But I'm living with two people who are bug-effing insane.
And that's coming from you.
Oh, jeez, I love them with all my heart, but I'm just telling you, they're just, like Wyatt works me out last night because I can't do the arm thing, but I do everything else, you know, legs and all that.
Sure.
And he thinks it's amusing to make fun of me because, you know, I may do a leg triceps with like 70 pounds and he does it with 100. And I point out I'm 72 and he's 14. Yeah.
Come on.
Hello, son.
Yeah.
And then, of course, he threatens to punch me in the neck. I mean, when he says it, though, it's so funny. It's just
it's like the Waltons.
You definitely got to be there.
That's a funny kid. Anyway, so here we are.
Here we are, is right.
Megan's wearing white today. Obviously, she's not getting married again. So.
Very pure, very pure.
She looks good.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
And everybody else is here. So, Little Richard, Larry King.
Sure.
Lieutenant Bill Cowan's coming up. So is Bernard McGurk and Imogen Lloyd Webber.
All right.
They're good. And Melissa Francis. If I told you that Melissa Francis, that they raided her house or whatever, where she lives, and found in her basement a refrigerator with a bunch of dead body parts. Well, of course you'd be dead. With a bunch of body parts in it.
What's wrong with you?
Do you know what you would say?
What would we say?
You'd say, really?
Yeah. What's the weather like?
And?
And? Yeah.
Have a great day.
How about that win last night?
Yeah.
All right, time for the news. We're way behind already. Here's some business news. To hear that is Deegan McDowell. Morning, Deegan.
Good morning, sir. Take a look at the futures, and they are slightly lower on the Dow this morning, down 13 points after the industrials lost 44 points yesterday. Again, our economy unexpectedly contracting during the last 3 months of the year, and then the Federal Reserve later in the day offering a very mixed review of growth in this country. And then the sale of the Hostess snack cake business is moving ahead. The bankrupt company that is liquidating, we're talking about the home of Twinkies and Snowballs, has singled out a bid from two private investment firms as kind of your minimum bid in the auction process, $410 million for the snack cake brands. It is Apollo Group and Metropolis, or Metropolis, however you say it. But it's important to note that second firm I'm talking about also owns Pabst Blue Ribbon. No. So PBR, and you get your Twinkies together, that's a Wednesday afternoon.
What's going on with Facebook?
Facebook reported its earnings, but the stock is way down this morning. It impressed, and the revenue was up. You can take a look on the Fox Business Network of how the stock is trading. But, again, lower, $29.35 is your bid on the stock this morning.
All right, 20 minutes left, the hour time. You know, after 7 years here on the I'm Smart program, Dan Marino had to figure that was never going to come out, right?
You would think. It was safe.
So yeah. It would be interesting. Who do you think dropped a dime on it, Deegan?
Taken.
I don't know, but she, after the baby was born, started leading a very obvious life. So, you know, kind of working the social circuit in New York, according to the New York Post. She had a place out in the Hamptons. She was being photographed. So it begs the question of where the money come from, right?
Yeah.
So she wasn't in hiding, so to speak.
What do you think, Lou?
I think Dagan's right. Sure. Plus, I don't care.
You weren't listening. You lie.
I actually don't care.
Warner?
Yeah, who cares?
Well,
I care more about Manti Te'o.
You know, maybe I don't know what the ramifications were on the money. Maybe there was a limitation. Maybe the money.
The money ran out.
Yeah, it's possible.
All the money.
I don't know.
Don't seem like you really care either. One.
Not really. I'm with Lou on that.
You're the guys in it.
No.
On it, yeah.
I mean, fortunately for the child, she's had someone to take care of her and has a mother and father now.
But I'm a Girk, Imogen Lloyd Webber coming up. Little Richard and Larry King. Oh, come on, man. I'm in the morning. All right, this portion of the Amish Wayne program. Sponsored by the Hackensack University Medical Center, a place where medicine meets innovation. It's time at 29 after the hour for a Bernie briefing. And with that, here's Bernard McGurk. What up, B?
Hey, Chief. Super Bowl Sunday coming up, and some controversy first on the front page of the New York Post, of course. Dan Marino's love child. That's nice. It's just something different. We had the Harbaugh brothers thing. That wasn't getting it done for us.
No.
So now we have Marino. And also now this San Francisco 49ers cornerback. His name is Chris Culliver. This is all over the place. He was on the Artie Lang radio show, wherever the hell that is. And they were talking sports. And he made some homophobic remarks.
What?
Take a listen to Artie Lang and San Francisco's 49ers cornerback, Chris Culliver.
I don't do the gay guys, man. I don't do that.
No. Are there any on the 49ers?
Nah.
Stop the thing.
They don't got no gay people on the team. You know, they got to get up out of here.
Don't
they
stop
do.
The thing.
Can't be with that sweet stuff. Nah.
Really, is that true?
Yeah, it's true.
But they might be able to play well. You're missing one of the most fascinating interviews in the history of the
NFL.
Why is the tape still playing?
In the locker room, nah.
Oh, okay. So they'd have to stay, keep it a secret.
Yeah, you gotta,
I'm sorry, I'm just hearing the tape
in my
ear.
10 years later after that.
Come out 10 years later after that, he says, and... of course, now he has apologized. Mm-hmm. And by the way, this is San Francisco, not exactly appealing to his base, I would say.
Yeah.
He issued this apology. The derogatory comments I made yesterday were a reflection of thoughts in my head, but they are not how I feel.
Hey, what happened?
No. It has taken me seeing them in print to realize that they are hurtful and ugly. I pledge to learn and grow from this experience. He said.
It might be the best apology of all time.
Yeah.
Thoughts in my head, but not how I feel.
Oh, now we understand.
That's me every morning.
Exactly.
So I know where that dude's coming from.
As you said earlier, he won't be going with Dan Marino to that Mensa meeting.
No.
I'll let you know if I see him there.
Okay.
Of course. And of course, boss, I promoted John Stewart hammering Senator Robert Menendez from New Jersey on this this underage prostitute scandal.
Something we were all looking forward to.
But it didn't happen.
Why?
I don't know. That's a good question. Why not? You would think, right? That would be the news of the day. It wasn't on any of the network newscasts. John Stewart, nobody. John Stewart focused on illegal immigration last night is what he did. And he talked about the amnesty for illegal immigrants. Take a listen to what he said.
My God, they talk about amnesty like it's some deviant sexual practice.
What I call backdoor amnesty.
We've all applied for that.
But Jay Leno, boss.
Yeah.
Jay Leno, the only guy.
That's not funny.
The only guy who addressed the Menendez thing. I mean, it's unbelievable. You think this is so juicy.
Yeah.
But listen to Jay Leno on the Menendez scandal.
Well, in more serious news, the FBI investigating New Jersey Senator Bob Menendez for allegedly soliciting Dominican prostitutes.
Ooh.
Wow. So once again, foreign workers doing the jobs Americans don't want to do, right? Yeah. Well, the FBI says Menendez agreed to pay the prostitutes $500, but then only gave them $100. So he had sex like a Democrat, but as a fiscal conservative like a Republican. That's what we need in Washington. We need more men like that.
At least he brought it up.
Yeah. Right.
Yes. All right. Two after the hour, Lieutenant.
Huh? Back to you, Tommy Lee Jones.
Lieutenant Colonel Bill Cowan is coming up, and then in the next hour, Bernard McGoick and Imogen Lloyd Webber. And then Melissa Francis will be in to try to clear up some of the conceptions we have, or perhaps misconceptions we have about that girl. Mm. Little Richard and Larry King are both here. All that stuff's coming up. 33 after the end. We have a new country station, radio station in New York.
Yeah.
Nash 94.7 is a great station, by the way. And whoever's programming the station, they're playing the right country music, so I know something about it.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody asked me if the kids who go to the Imus Cattle Ranch for Kids with Cancer like country music. And I said, no, they don't.
Really?
They hate country music.
Oh.
So, you have to remember, most of the kids over the past 14 years who've been to the ranch are all kids from urban areas.
Right.
And almost half the kids are kids from various minorities, and they're not interested in.
Yeah.
Well, they some country music. See, they, you know, they'd be surprised. I mean, like this song "Cruise" that we play once in a while by Florida Georgia Line. These two guys. I mean, that's a good record. So Jason Aldean, that's almost, you know, rock and roll. So a lot of it's pretty good stuff. And Taylor Swift, of course, which are hideously annoying records, but
yeah,
people love them to death. So,
oh.
But generally, they just say, because I play it all summer.
Of course, they don't change their mind when they're there?
No.
Oh.
No, they don't.
It's unfortunate.
I even got them where they, as a, just, they would thank me for playing Van Morrison.
Right.
So they didn't have to listen to any more Delbert or.
Right.
Warden, thank you.
Lady Antebellum or.
Warden.
Vince Gill or somebody.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just they, you know, they'd rather hear Rihanna or
sure, right before the parole.
Know, Swedish yeah. House Mafia, whatever they're called, or
yeah,
that's just the way it is.
Well,
so Rob said, "Well, don't you convert them?" No, you don't convert them.
Can't convert them.
Oh, they no.
Silly Rob.
You change their, you know, change make completely different people out of them. They stop walking around being defined by the fact that they have cancer, which is far more important than converting them to,
yes,
you know,
it is.
Country music. So, anyway, 7 minutes set, but I like it. A lot of other people do. So, and I bet this station does great in New York because,
mm-hmm.
Don't you think?
Yeah.
Because it's the right kind of, I mean, you'd be surprised. Look how much we play. So, anyway, coming up on 8 minutes after the hour, Bernard McGurk and Imogen Lloyd Webber are coming up. And then Melissa Francis will be in.
Yeah.
We have a bunch of news, mostly that Dan Marino has a love child.
That is in the news in the New York Post. Yep.
And Senator Menendez from New Jersey been stiffing the hookers in the Dominican Republic.
So goes the allegation. Yep.
Yeah. But let's start things off with some entertainment news.
Mm-hmm.
And here with that is the great Little Richard. Morning, Richard.
Good morning.
Yeah.
A wop, babaloo, bop, a wop, bamboo. New York Senator Chuck Schumer is hollering like an old white woman because Beyonce hasn't apologized to him for lip-syncing at the president's inauguration. It was Obama's inauguration. Beyonce lip-syncing didn't bother Obama. It wasn't like the president was out there screaming, "Hey, Beyonce, you didn't sing that." Yeah. See what I did there?
Yeah.
You didn't sing that. Senator, if I were you, I'd just shut the front door on this particular issue. I'm sure Chuck Schumer has been in the presence of quite a few women who have faked their orgasms and performances.
Well.
I'm sorry. I'm so excited to be here. At least this time, Charles, you didn't have to leave the money on the dresser after the fake screaming stopped.
Oh.
Beyonce is going to be singing at the real, for real, at the Super Bowl. They ain't never asked me to sing there. I love football. Especially when the tight end goes deep. Shut up. Speaking of tight ends, although by now he's probably a wide receiver, 82-year-old Jim Nabors married his longtime partner. Mm-hmm. Jim Nabors said it was time to come out of the closet. Child, please. Jim Nabors have been in the closet so long, the moths are gay. I always liked Jim Nabors. He played a Marine on his show. Marines say they're looking for a few good men. I know that's right. Shut up.
Yeah.
You know, here's my, I guess I'm kind of curious about. Then didn't you write that?
I wrote it all.
Okay.
I was the originator.
Okay.
The creator.
Mm-hmm.
But you read it like you'd never seen it before.
Well, I've been reading all a whole bunch of things, honest. I've been reading a whole lot of things.
Yeah.
That could be one of the worst performances out of either one of you stiffs in recent memory.
I hate you.
I hate you.
Was it the, what was it, Bigfoot? The personnel operating the teleprompter? What happened there?
No, I take full responsibility.
You're right. How did it become either one of you stiffs? So
can you not read with those glasses on or what?
No, I can read fine.
Shut
I
up.
Can see you, and that's a problem.
Shut up.
You
Shut
sucked, up. And that sucked.
Well, I have sucked.
Oh, God.
Oh.
Yeah. All right.
Okay. You in a bad mood now?
It's going to be all right.
Well, what are you going to do?
We're going to work
is
through
you
it.
Gonna
it's live.
We're going to work through it.
There used to be a reason we taped all this stuff, so.
Right.
Because some of the performers are so hungover, we had to walk them through it. But all right, 10 after the hour, time for some news.
It's okay.
I'm in abject agony anyway.
Yeah, the left arm.
Oh, God.
Shoulder.
But, I mean, I'm not going to. It's better
track.
That
I got it, Lou.
Than I have to deal with what I have to deal with at home.
Right.
If I just. I don't get going.
Mm-hmm. No, please.
All right, here's Connell with some news. Morning, Connell.
All right, good morning, I-Man. Chinese hackers targeting the New York Times. Paper has a big article about it this morning saying the hacking, which they say has been stopped, started after the Times was exposing lucrative business dealings of the Chinese premier, Wen Jiabao. Oh. Also this morning, Israel reported to have conducted airstrikes inside of Syria, hitting a truck convoy and a scientific research center. The Syrian government denouncing the attack, calling it a breach of Syrian sovereignty. Then you mentioned the story involving New Jersey Senator Robert Menendez denying these allegations of hiring underage prostitutes in the Dominican Republic. The office of one of his political donors in Florida raided by federal agents yesterday. We have this comment I'll play for you by the senator himself speaking on our friend Geraldo's radio show back in November. That's when the story about the prostitution first broke. The Daily Caller website had it. Menendez was claiming that they were trying to sabotage his career.
Well, listen, Geraldo, that story's false, absolutely false and contrived, and it's no surprise it's coming out 5 days before the election. You know, the source is clearly not credible, and beyond that, I'm not going to dignify that right-wing website with any further response.
Sure. That was November, so it's still going on.
What does that sound like to you, Warner?
Feed.
Yeah. Sound like nonsense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So what should he have said?
Well, that's a good question. I don't know what he should have said, but he certainly, you know, if you're innocent, you don't start with the others. You say, look, I didn't do it. I didn't do it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's all, because that's your natural reaction.
Exactly.
So when you start talking about something else, oh, no, you're deflecting.
Is the stature of Dan Marino diminished in your eyes, Warner, as a result of this?
No.
It's not.
Look, he's not a deadbeat dad. I think that's a plus for him. It's not right, of course, what he did because he was married.
Why don't you go home and see if Mrs. Wolf feels about that?
That's good.
Why don't you go home and tell her you have a love child, see what she thinks?
Hey, wait a minute. The flesh is weak. I mean, like the Bible says, who are we to throw stones?
Okay, well. Right? Are you something you want to tell us?
No.
Well, it sounds to me like
you're inching
up on something, doesn't it?
I have no love child that I know about.
Do we know that, Bernie? Well, Bernie's not there.
No, sir. I mean, Guns doesn't look like Warner.
Hey, Guns.
What's up, baby?
Is Warner your dad?
Possibly. You never know.
Connell continues. Come on.
All right. Right. Well,
definitely possible.
Where am I?
Look at the two of them over there.
All right. They look very much alike to me.
Something going on.
Hurry up. Come on.
Don't know about. In Alabama, still no resolution to that hostage situation involving the 5-year-old little boy that was kidnapped Tuesday afternoon off the school bus. A gunman came on the bus, shot and killed the driver, and police still said to be outside this bunker where 65-year-old guy Jimmy Lee Dykes is believed to be holding the little boy. Here's one of his neighbors, says the guy's a little unhinged, and she claims he attacked her dog one time when it wandered over the property line.
He took a lead pipe, and he beat Max until he could just barely make it home.
Terrible story there in Alabama, still the little boy being held, and the weather is also a big story, I-Man. Tornadoes and other strong storms ripping through the southeast have now claimed at least 2 lives.
All right, let's do some business news, 14 after the hour. And with that, here's Dagan McDowell. Morning, Dagan.
Good morning, sir. Dow futures are off by just 8 points after a 44-point loss yesterday. But Facebook on its face this morning. That stock down more than 6% in pre-market trading, close to $29 a share. Investors clearly had incredibly high expectations for the company's quarterly report on earnings and profits, but it looked to be solid. Fourth quarter revenue was up 40%. Facebook's ramping up its mobile advertising business. Got to do that. It now makes up almost 1/4 of all ad revenue. That is good news, but there was already a lot of that very thing in the stock because it had gained from its low last year. More than 65%, so a little bit of a pullback.
Thanks, Dagan. Quarter after. Morning, Dagan.
Hold on a second here. That was my mistake.
What happened to Dagan?
Well, you know how
he didn't turn Dagan. Connell didn't turn my mic on.
Easy.
Yeah. Yeah, he'll payback comes later. Payback comes later.
Hit the wrong button.
Yeah, I got a button you can hit.
No, I bet you do.
or a spot, rather.
God. What? Snap. Glad I got this thing turned on.
What are you, nuts?
Yes. Come on.
That Tim Tebow GQ cover.
God, this would be pretty good on a Araldo show.
Yeah, I was sitting up here looking at the Tim Tebow photos, thinking about a T-Chez sandwich. You know what I'm saying?
Clearly. Yeah, we know.
Hey,
honestly, right. God, I mean, nice. You can't make this up.
No, you gotta love it, though. You wouldn't want to.
Right.
Morning, boss. Well, first of all, let me read from Gawker.com, Chief.
All right.
That's okay with you?
Sure.
A Taco Bell ad chastising party poopers who bring veggie platters to game day has been pulled following a Twitter campaign launched by the Center for Science and the Public Interest. Concerned that the commercial might discourage people from eating veggies, CSPI asked veggie lovers to tweet their complaints at Taco Bell, and the company eventually decided to pull the ad off the air.
Oh.
Now, this is a 15-second ad, and I know the I-Man's been, this is near and dear to your heart with the veggies and all, and they're just sucking the joy out of the fun of the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
This is the Taco Bell ad that they pulled off the air because it offended everybody. Take a listen.
Right. Veggies on game day is like punting on 4th-and-1. It's a cop-out, and secretly, people kind of hate you for it. Introducing Taco Bell's Variety Taco 12-Pack. 6 crunchy tacos and 6 Doritos Locos tacos. A game day tradition since right now.
Well, I'm down with Taco Bell on that one.
Yeah,
absolutely. The Taco Bell spokesman, this dude Rob Posch, said, quote, "We didn't want anyone to misinterpret the intent of the ad," unquote. What a bunch of P-words.
Yeah.
I mean, are you kidding me? Unbelievable. Anyway, these people respond.
I don't eat Taco Bell stuff,
really?
But I don't tell. But I think people should eat what they want to eat. And they ought to be, you know. There shouldn't be bad-mouthing the veggies, by the way. But out of that, the Taco Bell people.
It's a joke.
Yeah.
I know you
it's
know.
It's not funny.
No.
Oh, it's not funny?
Well, see, we're not bad-mouthing there. If you want to eat Taco Bell stuff, fine. Have a good time.
Mm.
Well, these knuckleheads at Gawker.com, they concluded by writing the following. Close call. For a minute there, Taco Bell nearly lost a bunch of vegetarian customers in the business of health food advocacy group. Yeah, yeah. And speaking of people with spines or without them, remember that Volkswagen ad we played yesterday with the guys with the Jamaican accents, the white guys? Everybody, well, apparently some people were up in arms that some white guys were doing Jamaican accent. Here's a piece of the ad. It's for Volkswagen. Yeah. Right. Don't worry, feel happy. Take a listen.
No worries, man. Everything will be all right.
Yeah, man.
Oh, don't fret me, brother. Sticky bun comes soon. Yeah. Wicked coffee, Mr. Jim. You know what this room needs? A smile. Who wanna come with I?
Don't be no cloud on a sunny day.
Yeah, chill, Winston.
Sir?
Respect, boss man.
Here's what I don't understand.
Right.
There had to be some reason that these white guys were affecting this accent.
Right. It was
it contained in the commercial, wasn't there?
Right. In other words, you buy a Volkswagen, you'll be happy. You'll be a happy person, like a Jamaica. Don't worry, be happy.
Yeah,
Jamaica, no problem, man.
That type of thing. Right.
And that was the idea, but the one...
Well, why not have Jamaicans do it then?
Wouldn't be as funny, I guess.
Exactly right. And by the way...
But there's got to be a reason. But there's no reason that all the white guys are doing Jamaican accent?
Actually, there was one Asian guy in the Volkswagen also. But it was...
It would have been funnier had they had a variety of people, ethnic groups, doing the accent. Then it would have been funny.
Well, a lot of people liked it, thought it was a very funny ad, and the accent itself is a very endearing. If somebody does it, it's not to make fun. It's an endearing
can
accent.
You do it?
Just like...
You do it, right?
Yeah, man, bumba clot, man, listen
about
to
you,
me.
Lou?
That's the ting,
boy. Man, Jamaica, you crazy, man. Yeah,
so, okay,
man.
Well...
We're the rolling papers, man.
Yeah.
Now, it's just the same thing with the Pakistani, the Indian, even the English language. Yeah. We're fascinated by it, but in any case... The Volkswagen people decided they're going to keep it on the air, and now they have the blessing of the girls on The View. Take a listen to Whoopi Goldberg and Sherry Shepherd, boss.
One critic is calling it, quote, blackface with voices. And I have to take offense. I take offense to that because that saying that means that you don't realize that there are white folks who grew up in the Caribbean as well.
Because out of many, we are one people.
Because I caught up my girlfriend who is from Jamaica, and she loved it. She said, Sherry,
waterboard me. Waterboard me.
In other words, it's all good now.
Oh, good.
Yeah, we have the blessing of the ladies on the
view. Yeah, it's all good.
You're all good, Volkswagen.
Hey, man,
don't worry, be happy.
Hey. The view is
30
good,
minutes
man.
After the hour.
I love the view, man.
Bernard McGurk and Imogene Lloyd Webber are next.
That's the ting, man.
Oh, I'm thinking I'm actually in such agony.
Radio.
But I'm thinking about going home. I can't stand it.
Some weight loss show.
Oh, God, it's tough. Being too fat to play with your kids.
Oh, man.
Come on, how fat is that, dude?
Dad, let's play tag.
Huh? Let's ride dead. So, all right, please welcome down the Amazon Wayne Program, Imogene Lloyd Webber and Bernard McGurk. Good morning, Miss Lloyd Webber.
Good morning, Imus.
Good morning, Mr. McGurk.
Morning, Chief.
Time now for Bernie and Imogene to debate the issues. Are you into the Super Bowl at all, Imogene?
Well, apparently around 196 million Americans won't be watching the Super Bowl.
Won't.
While 113 million will. So it's okay if I don't, but I probably will. I like watching the adverts, and I want to watch Beyonce and see if she lip syncs.
Let me translate. Adverts means commercials.
Commercials. Yeah.
Did it bother you that she lip synced the national anthem at the inauguration?
Well, I was a bit bothered, and then apparently Whitney Houston may have lip synced at the Super Bowl.
Yeah, 20
back
years
in,
ago.
Exactly. And then I thought, well, okay, then if Whitney Houston couldn't do it, then
why are you picking on a dead woman?
Oh. Well, I'm not.
Away a long time ago. Yeah. No, I'm just kidding with you. No, that's a good point. There's a precedent.
Yeah.
That's
what I'm saying is,
your point.
If the best singer ever lip synced,
would you watch the Super Bowl?
I will watch the pregame just for Dan Marino, the look on his mutton-headed face now that he's been busted with a love child. But to be honest, Chief, I'll watch it for the commercials and the halftime show. But this game, there's nothing to get jacked up over. The Harbaugh brothers subplot, I just don't care about it at all. The 49ers versus the Ravens, what does it matter to me who wins? I totally just don't care. Plus, it's a Sunday night. And, you know, it's a big night where people are sucking down beers and eating bad food. You're going to wake up with a hangover, heartburn, and you're going to want to kick yourself. Yeah. I can't do it on a Sunday night. So
you and Deirdre are sucking the joy out of what is essentially a national holiday.
Right.
Yes, they should make it. Exactly. That's my point. They should make it a Saturday night. What the hell is with this Sunday night stuff?
Yeah.
No, but who can enjoy that on a Sunday night when the clock's going to go off at, you know.
Hmm. Apparently, 100 million chicken wings are going to be eaten.
Yeah.
Mm. Well, but what's interesting,
fact.
To put it in perspective, that Imogen introduced to us, is that 200 million people won't watch it.
Yeah.
Won't watch it.
No.
No.
Now, 113 million people watch, that's a lot of folks.
Yeah.
I hope it's a blowout early on in the first quarter, and that the number just dwindles. I just that kind of misery for the networks would just delight me to no end.
Martha McCallum is a Fox News anchor.
Yeah.
Maybe one of the. Do we think she's the best? She's really good.
Very good.
Very good.
I've been on with Martha.
Huh? Yeah.
Yeah.
And so she's enamored of the royal family.
That's why I've been on with Martha, yeah.
Okay.
We sit there and talk the royal family.
Okay.
Yeah.
So and I ask her if she thought Prince Harry was a dope. And she said yes. Do you?
Yeah, I mean, he wasn't the fizziest drink in the fridge, especially comparing killing Taliban to
Pink. He wasn't the what?
Fizziest drink in the fridge.
Okay,
got it.
And he was comparing killing the Taliban to playing PlayStation, and that was very insensitive. In saying that, you know, give it to Prince Harry here. Most rich kids now, they don't go to war. They don't fight for their country. They haven't really, I mean, obviously with the draft in Vietnam, they did a bit, although there's all that dodging the draft with Vietnam. So good on Prince Harry for actually going to war and doing something and not staying at home and being a complete wastrel.
What do you think?
I think he makes Dan Marino look like Stephen Hawking, actually. He's not very bright. He's like the Lindsay Lohan of the royal family.
Right.
But as Imogen pointed out, at least he's not, there's a pretense of not being a total parasite, and you have to hand the kid that. But I mean, you know, you got to dummy up. But some of the things he was saying about video games and his thumbs and.
Do you think Prince Charles is his father?
Yes.
You know?
Yes. Shall we settle this? Okay, everyone's saying that perhaps James Hewitt is Harry's dad.
He looks like James Hewitt.
It's impossible. Harry was born in September 1984. She didn't meet James Hewitt until the summer of 1986. Harry gets his red hair from the Spencer family. Oh. So end of the conspiracy theory now.
Anybody do a DNA test?
Yeah, but she was...
Well, that will mess up royal families for centuries, so I think we stay off the DNA test with royal families.
And Harry might have to get a job at... Oh, well, his mom is royalty, so he would.
Speaking of football, President Obama said that had he had a son, or if he had a son, he's not sure he'd let him play football because of the prospect of the kid being injured. And I have a 14-year-old who's a calf roper in rodeo, which is dangerous. Well, I wouldn't let it. I'd let him do that, but I wouldn't let him play football. So, how about you?
Well, listen. The chance. I would tend to agree with Obama on this because the odds of any kid making it in the NFL, and even when players do make it in the NFL, they only last. The lifespan is what, 2 or 3 years career for most of the athletes.
Yeah. Four and a half.
Four and a half says Warner Wolf. So I would discourage it. Actually, I'd steer him towards ballet or something like that.
Yeah. Following in your footsteps.
Yes, tights and the prospect of a lot of money.
Your son's kind of hunky. Isn't he a lifeguard and all that stuff?
Yes, he is. But
how old is he? I'm beginning to perk up a bit.
Oh, he's cute.
He's 19.
Oh, a bit too young, sadly.
Calm down, Emily. You have any thoughts on this?
I think they've just done a study, haven't they, that NFL players are four times more likely to get brain disease than ordinary or sort of normal Americans. So you can see why President Obama would say this. I think he's just echoing what most parents probably think by the sounds of
it. And you had that other player say that at some point, one of the Ravens said that at some point somebody's going to die on the field. That'll be the catalyst, as Newtown was the catalyst for change in gun laws. And unfortunately said, but that might be true.
Unfortunate example or analogy or whatever. Women in combat, something you think okay?
I think what's interesting is looking at the Joint Chiefs of Staff, who are unanimous in deciding this, and certainly don't ask, don't tell, they weren't unanimous on that one. And I think it's because women in combat has already really been happening. And when you look at the specifics, women still won't be able to make some combat units because they won't meet the physical requirements. So I think actually this has been blown up out of proportion if you actually read the small print.
I would say.
You hate me.
No, I don't hate anybody, especially not you. But it's not so much the physical requirement. If they can pass the test, then you would think, okay, fine. It's human sexuality. I can't believe the naivety on the part of people on this issue, putting women in the front lines, extended deployments out in the field. You're gonna have envy, jealousy, chivalry, pregnancy, sexual assaults, breakups. You're gonna have the guys worried about relieving themselves in the bush with some babe eyeballing them out there in the woods or whatever. All those things come into play. As I said, if you have a Captain Bill Clinton who's in charge, and you got PFC Kate Upton and Corporal Imogene Lloyd Webber on in your squad, is Bill Clinton going to be worried about his unit, or is he going to be worried about his unit?
Where are you with gays in the military?
I'll say this: it's all PC feel good stuff, and I'm for gays in the military. However, the reality is, no matter what they tell you about people, the mindset has changed with young people. Listen to what that football player said yesterday about gays are not welcome in the locker room. I don't think the military should be at the forefront of these social experiments. Why are there no openly gay professional athletes? Let's experiment there. And why aren't there any openly gay? Where are all the brave hearts who pound on the military? Why aren't they pounding on the on sports, professional sports? Because it would be too difficult for them.
But Bernard, 250,000 women have been deployed to both Iraq and Afghanistan, and you're saying that they shouldn't have the ability to move up in ranks and so forth?
No, absolutely.
That's all the Joint Chiefs were doing.
My daughter has been nominated for attendance at a military academy. She should have all the equality that anyone should be able to have.
Yeah,
all
four. She's been nominated because of her extraordinary sports ability.
Well, whatever it is, she's going to be she may be part of the military, and I want her to have all the opportunities that every other woman can have. But the reality is, out in the field, there are going to be major problems. I don't see how anybody can deny that. It just boggles my mind that you just discount that. We haven't had a war like that since Vietnam, really. These Iraq and Afghanistan deployments are a little bit different. These women weren't in the infantry. They're in combat zones, and they should get combat pay. But if you have a different type of war out in the field, again, there's no supervision, and you got Sergeant Anthony Weiner and Lieutenant Bob Menendez. I think we're gonna run into some problems.
I just don't think you've been looking at the small print enough, and that's why it was universally endorsed by the Joint Chiefs of Staff, is that each unit will have the ability to make a decision, and so therefore some units women are never ever going to serve.
14 till they are. Talk with Imogene Lloyd Webber and Bernard McGuirk while they're debating the issues. Doing so in spirited fashion. There's a sheriff in Milwaukee County who says that people, you can't rely on, if somebody breaks in your house, you can't rely on calling 911. You need to arm yourself. You need to have a firearm, and you need to know how to use it. Now, I know friends of mine who don't own guns, and I've asked them, I said, what are you going to do if somebody breaks in your house, and they don't know? So where are you on that? So, Sheriff Wright?
Well, I don't really think that vigilante justice is a good thing, and you can't blame somebody for not having a gun. I'm sorry, I don't know where you are on this, Bernard, but you can't blame someone for not having a gun and wanting to call 911.
No, you can't.
You should be right.
I am afraid of guns. I don't own a gun.
No, neither
Tough
do
guy
I.
That I might,
what are you going to do if somebody breaks in your house with a gun?
I'm going to cry and call 911 and hide in the closet and send my wife out to go see what's happening.
Perfect.
Also, I mean,
by the way, the best kind of gun to have in your house is a pump action shotgun. So,
yeah.
Because having a pistol is a waste of time, because unless you can shoot like, say, I can or someone, nobody can hit anything with a pistol. Even if you know how to shoot one, why, it's hard to hit. So get yourself a shotgun.
Isn't there a
if you're going to have a gun. If not, well.
Isn't there a stat that says that most suicides are committed by people with guns because it's nice and clean and easy? In other words, I'm afraid of having guns around. You get liquored up and angry, and I just don't like it.
And I actually agree with you, Bernard, because Americans are five times more likely than any other developed country in the world to die from an unintentional firearm death.
Right.
Five times more likely than any other developed country.
Either an accident or suicide or murder.
I'm not sure where I am on this. So I own guns, but I'm not recommending that people do it.
You don't have to own a gun. It shouldn't be compulsory. You should have a choice in this.
You know, one of the things we do know, there are too many guns in this country.
Yeah.
There are too many guns in the hands of the wrong people. So.
And if you live in the city as opposed to rural areas, it's different. Like, I grew up in the city. But if you live somewhere where 911 will take them a half hour to get there, you might want to own that.
shotgun.
All right. Super Bowl prediction, even though neither one of you care.
Now, I went to Nate Silver on this, who did very well predicting the U.S. presidential election. Well, he's the expert. I'm going to have to read it out because I don't understand what it means. 49ers will beat Ravens with defense.
Okay.
That's what Nate Silver says, so must be true.
I think it's Ray Lewis's year. He's going to go out. He's going to go out on a high note, and I have no idea. I just thought I'd take a stab at it.
Okay, Ravens and 49ers. Bernard and Imogene here on the I'm Swain program. It is 12 minutes till the hour. Melissa Francis, we'll get to the bottom of where this girl's coming from. And I.
Ladies and gentlemen, Imus in the morning.
I had an email here from Dave Pearson, Henderson, North Carolina. Hi, man. Taylor Swift splashed all over publications with her new so-called new sexy look, but it's a knockoff of our queen of pure rock and hotness, Dagan McDowell's old hairstyle. Is that right?
Oh, yeah.
Rip off.
Dagan slammed it. Taylor looks hideous. Well, I don't think it's
that's what Taylor's
necessary
doing.
Necessary to be disparaging poor little Taylor Swift. Or
no.
Who should I rip off?
Girl can't keep a man. She's got to do something.
And try to look like Dagan.
That D. McDowell's got it going on.
Uh-huh.
Well,
yeah. Drop that haircut, McDowell.
She gets an album out of every one of these affairs or relationships she has.
Sure.
So it could be the grand design. I know a lot of songwriters in Nashville who write a book. You know, I forget who said it, write about what you know.
So. Getting dumped over and over.
Some of the great songs have been written by some of the great songwriters are, you know.
Yep.
Stuff that happened to them.
Desperation is an awful perfume.
Oh, wow.
It's an old.
Here's another one. Who cares?
Southern proverb.
This is from Susan in Wyandotte, Michigan. Susan writes, WTF. Who cares? He dipped his wick many years ago.
Susan, God.
He financially supported his actions. Why is this even news? I suspect she's talking about Dan Marino.
Mr. Marino, yeah.
Who splashed all over the front page of the New York Post with a 7-year-old love child. And why this has just been introduced to us now suggests to me that, well, somebody dropped a dime on poor old Dan. So.
Yeah.
Apparently a production assistant there at CBS. And one thing led to another, and here you go.
Got a Marino statement that's come out. This is a personal and private matter. I take full responsibility, both personally, financially, for my actions, now as I did then, and we mutually agreed to keep our arrangement private, protect all parties involved, Mr. Marino says. So.
Desperation, a bad perfume.
That's right.
What do we know about the woman involved, Dagan?
She was a young professional woman. After the baby was born, she moved to Texas for a time, moved back here. It's been kind of on the society scene. This will pass for two reasons, quality and quantity. It was only one woman that we know of, and she was of fairly high quality. It was a professional woman, unlike Tiger Woods, who, remember, he was even banging that manager at the Perkins in the parking lot.
Perkins.
You know?
So, what's Perkins?
It's a restaurant chain.
Like a relative of Denny's, isn't it? Yeah. It's kind of that.
You know, turn her around so you don't have to look at her type gal.
Thank you, Dagan.
Well, how are those women any less
how's it going, Connell?
Everything's
caring, feeling human being than this professional woman who Marino hosed over there at CBS?
She had one tryst with a high-quality woman. That is better than multiple trysts with, well, you know, the kind of women that you don't want to be seen with in the broad daylight.
You really are just, I don't know.
Breaking it down.
Yep.
Hideously bigoted human being.
Yeah, of course.
9 minutes after the hour, here's Larry King now with
desperation.
Let's see if with his essay that he wrote.
Right.
Let's see if he can read this. Morning, Larry.
Oh, well, why am I being pulled into this before I've even started?
Yeah.
Well, we'll see.
Well, one thing's for sure. Jim Nabors won't be showing up in the 49ers locker room this Sunday.
No.
He just married his partner of 38 years, Stan Cadwalader, which makes it official. Goma Pyle is gay. Surprise, surprise, surprise.
Shazam.
He's been out to friends and family for years, but this is the first time he's actually acknowledged his sexuality to the media, which is about the worst-kept secret since the one about Kenny Rogers having some work done. Yeah. I guess at 82, it's pretty much a moot point. Not like him being gay is going to keep him from getting any of those choice roles in Hollywood. You're an 82-year-old actor. You're pretty much typecast as either the crotchety old bastard yelling at the kids to stay off your lawn or a dead ringer for the title role in the Iggy Pop story. Don't get me wrong. I'm happy that Goma finally had the opportunity to come out because it's not like he could have done it back in Mayberry, although I'm sure there were more than a few citizens who used to visit the gay bars in Mount Pilot. I wouldn't be shocked if Bonnie Fife and Floyd the Barber had a thing on the QT.
Yeah.
Goober, with that stupid jughead hat of his, was probably a twink. And I always thought Aunt B was just one big old lesbian. Fat old spinster with short hair. She was like Gertrude Stein with pie. Well, golly! Yeah. Bison Bone Steel, South Dakota. What do you got for Roscoe Lee Brown?
Larry right, King here on the Outer Throwing Program. Let's do some news. This is news.
Yeah.
12 after the hour, and here with that is Dagan McDowell. What's up, Dagan?
Good morning, sir. Futures are off by 8 points. That's the Dow futures. And we're waiting for that big January jobs report, which comes out tomorrow from the government. Again, maybe Stuart Varney will deliver that for us. But ahead of that, last hour we found out from Challenger, Gray, and Christmas how many layoffs happened for the month. They were up. More than 40,000 people got laid off in January. That was up 24% from December, but down 24% from a year ago. That's good news. Bottom of this hour, we get weekly jobless claims and also personal income and spending for last month. Again, could move the markets. We'll have that for you.
All right. There you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm talking to Bigfoot, but
yeah. Right.
Well, I have the intercom press. I can't tell what's going on.
No. Dagan brought us up to speed on all the business news, and we're good to go to sports now.
Right, we were going to do some simulcast of some businesses. When was that going to occur, Bigfoot?
It's going to occur tomorrow. Right. Usually Stuart Varney does it.
Right.
But he is off tomorrow.
Oh, man.
Really?
So Connell is going to
so they're going to have Connell do it.
Oh, really?
Well, hot dang.
That's much due to my British accent.
Why Connell and how come Dagan didn't get to do it?
Oh.
I don't know.
Maybe just Connell.
Yeah.
Compare the accents.
Be able to handle it better or something.
Yeah, I'm biting.
Maybe they'll
my
do
lip.
It as a team.
Could we? Sure. Certainly open to that. We're
of course.
A team every morning at 11
exactly.
o'clock.
Exactly.
Tally ho, now back to you, Connell.
Thank you,
13 after the hour. Let's do sports. Commercials.
All right.
Yeah, man, thank you very much, Connell.
You're welcome.
It is coming up on 25 after the hour here on the IMS in the Morning program. I just got a text from my wife, who I love her to death. It's the reason I'm alive today. But she said, did you take the Medrol? Well, no, Deidre, I didn't. That's the whole point.
That's why you feel
you told
way.
Me not to take it.
Right. Uh-oh.
But she was just checking up on you.
Well, that's very nice of her.
It's 25 after. I had to go see Dr. Wu this morning.
Peekaboo.
To help Peekaboo see what he's up to.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the Adams Wine program is sponsored by the Breakers Palm Beach. Call 1-800-BREAKERS. Go to thebreakers.com. Boy, it is, man. Can you imagine being down there at the Breakers on the Atlantic Ocean, 5-acre beach?
Yep.
Gorgeous place. Man. Exquisite rooms and dining. And what are you, nuts?
Yeah, we should all go.
Oh, come on, man.
You and your squeeze.
Oh, well, come on.
I love it.
You let's think go. Of old Reverend Mason, if he actually loved it. I mean,
yeah.
Like the do say do. Mm-hmm. He woke up a thing where we'd be broadcasting live.
That's what I'm saying. Mm-hmm.
Go, man. Yeah, get the Pussy Riot going.
Yeah. Let's start the Pussy
Let's
Riot.
Start it up.
Right, Warner?
Breakers. Here's Benign McGurk.
Warner got up and left. Hey, come on. The riot.
You know,
Imogen
Lloyd Webber, what is she weigh? About 60 pounds?
Soaking wet, yeah.
Right. She's. She's a thin young lady.
That's a tiny little person. I tell you who else I saw yesterday walking in. Carly and I were walking out. Was that, hey, Carly?
Yeah, what's up?
Was that Lori Rothman we saw?
Yes, that was Lori Rothman we saw.
That's a tiny little person, too.
Mm-hmm. She is a little person.
That girl is
both beautiful.
Right.
Yeah, that's a tiny girl.
Yeah.
Her partner, Melissa Francis.
Yes.
She's coming in.
Oh, good.
I'll turn him in.
Mm-hmm.
But 26 after the hour, Bernie has a briefing. Hey,
can you keep your hands above the console there,
exactly
boss?
Exactly right.
Jeez.
He with a bad shoulder.
You really do need to calm down a little.
Take it easy there. The hell's the old guy's name in the movie theater? I can't even remember.
Fred Berger?
Fred Willard.
Good morning, Bernard.
Good morning, boss. Well.
Wow.
Speaking of, well, there won't be any Pussy Riot in this following story. Remember Gomer Pyle from the Andy Griffith Show and Gomer Pyle USMC?
Well, he won't be starting a Pussy Riot.
That's exactly right, boss.
Shazam,
exactly right.
Yeah.
Well, listen, he just got married.
Oh, okay.
He's 82 years old.
Good. God
he
bless
married
him.
His longtime boyfriend, who is 65. The guy was a fireman. He met him like 30 years ago. No hose jokes.
Get that fire going.
And in any case, he's a
Kenya Lightman.
Very nice old dude, this Jim Nabis, former singer also. Shazam. Anyway, here he is explaining getting married.
Surprise, surprise, surprise.
I'm 82, and he's in his 60s, and so we've been together for 38 years, and I'm not ashamed of people knowing. It's just that it was such a personal thing. I didn't tell anybody.
Yeah.
That's nice guy. God bless him.
Get the PD riot started or whatever. And speaking of gay, Chief, this Ronaya Tuasosopo, the guy, the mastermind of the hoax on Manti Te'o, he appeared on Dr. Phil yesterday, and Jimmy Kimmel got a clip of him on with Dr. Phil, played it last night, and had a comment. Take a listen.
Dr. Phil was on the Today Show this morning to promote the interview and explain the motivation behind this diabolical scheme.
Here we have a young man that fell deeply romantically in love.
And does he say that? Does he say I fell in love?
I asked him straight up, was this a romantic relationship with you? And he says yes. I said, are you then therefore gay? And he said, well, when you put it that way, yes.
What other way can you put it? Maybe the Air Force threw him off? I don't know. Maybe you'd like him to put it in song? I saw a few clips from this interview today. I'm not sure what to make of this guy. I don't know if I even believe he's gay. And I think everyone is gay, by the way. But
and the kid himself actually said, I am confused. But, I mean, this kid's not a victim. This guy perpetrated a hoax on this poor Manti Te'o, as far as we know now.
Yeah.
In any case, speaking of Jimmy Kimmel and the Super Bowl is Sunday, he had a couple of jokes on the Super Bowl, Chief. See if this amuses the eye man.
Sure.
Super Bowl parties are a lot of fun. It's one of the most fun parties, I think. It's also a really great way to give your friends all the flu at once. Hey, everyone, I sneezed in the salsa. On Sunday, the San Francisco 49ers battled the Baltimore Ravens in New Orleans. This is interesting. A new study conducted by the Public Religious Research Institute says 27% of Americans believe that God has a hand in determining which team wins. So if you're praying for a new kidney this weekend, sorry, God has the Ravens in the over. What they call the proposition or prop bets. Like, this is a real bet that you can make. Will any player on either active roster be arrested before the Super Bowl? If you say yes, bet $100, and if you win, you'll win $550. And by the way, if I'm a cop in New Orleans, I take that bet, then arrest the first player I see.
Up against the car.
30 minutes after the hour. Thank you, Bernard.
Yes, sir.
Melissa Francis is next. 20 minutes past the hour here in the I'm Mr. Wayne program. Let me read something to you that you will never, ever be able to get out of your head, because I haven't been able to when I read it. It's from Diary of a Stage Mother's Daughter by Melissa Francis. This is the opening page introduction. She pulled to the side of the road and told me to get out. Find your own way home and another place to live while you're at it. With a deep breath, I pushed the release button on my seatbelt and slowly tumbled out. This had been coming for years, and I almost welcomed it. I was relieved that it had finally happened, and I wouldn't have to wonder when anymore. I'd watched my mom throw my older sister out of the car countless times. Tiffany would walk sadly, pathetically along the sidewalk until my mom finally circled the car around and picked her up, waiting longer and driving farther each time to intensify the humiliation. Now it was my turn. I was 8 years old. And then she goes on to explain that when she got out of the car, Melissa, she ran up and hid by a local on a golf course down the road there. So her mother drove around again and then drove around again and looked. And finally stopped driving around and went home. And Melissa somehow found her way home. So, and it's all I ever read of the book. Please welcome to the Amherst Morning Program, Melissa Francis. Good morning, Ms. Francis.
What a buzzkill. I don't want to bring everyone down this
morning.
What
a horrible.
You guys are having a good time. And
what a horrible.
I come out here with my sob story just to cry all over your set. No.
See, and
no,
I'm,
I won't do it.
I'm convinced that you're insane.
Well, what my husband thinks. A lot of people think that. You wouldn't be alone in that thought.
I don't mean in a bad way, by the way. I know it's but
I'm good insane. I'm not familiar with that. What is that?
Well, I just think that you've got issues, probably. I mean, you're just... my wife loves you, by the way, because you're smart, and I'm not patronizing you, but and you and what's her name, Lori?
Lori Rothman, she's so cute. You could pop her on the end of a keychain and dangle her from your purse. She's so cute, isn't she adorable? I love that girl.
Wow, that sounds like a plan. Yeah.
Carly and I met her walking in. That's a tiny little girl.
She is. That's what I say. She'd make a great keychain.
But if someone were to say to me, "Hey, did you hear Melissa Francis has human body parts in a refrigerator in her basement?"
Oh, you would say that makes sense. Stop. That's logical.
I would say, well, okay.
Yeah, okay. You know, so you're saying that my husband is a brave man and Lori's pretty brave too.
Well, I'm not sure, but I mean, how did this book do?
It's doing great. Yeah, selling like hotcakes. Thanks to you. You come out and hawk it like crazy. Although I don't like the part where you say that you never read past that. I mean, come on.
Because I can't do it.
No?
Because I don't want to know what just brutally horrible.
There are very funny scenes. It does make you laugh out loud. It makes you cry, too. But there's a lot of laughter in there, too. It's nuanced. That's what makes a great book.
I always wonder, how does a person who endures that come out the other end, okay? You seem actually to be serious. You seem fine, but, I mean, there may be a dark side that we don't know about, so maybe you'll talk about this morning or not, perhaps not.
I don't, that could be the next book. That might be the follow-up, the dark side that
whatever
comes
happened,
out of that.
Now, you and your mother were estranged for years, were you?
Yes,
and
yes.
And where is she now?
She's still in California.
Is she alive?
Yes, yeah. We don't have any contact now.
Why?
It's just,
because of that?
No, at one point in my, I mean, to have a Dr. Phil moment, you know, at one point in my life, I said, we need to have a reset and have an adult relationship where, you know, and I'll forget everything that happened in the past. Let's sit down and start fresh. But, you know, none of this nonsense can go on any longer because I can't take it. No. And she hung up on me and I never heard from her again.
Makes me feel bad for you.
No, I'm okay. You don't have to feel bad for me. I'm resilient.
You're a very likable person, by the way.
You know, at the end of the book, thank you for that. At the end of the book, you get the sense that everybody sort of has a trauma in their life. Everybody's been through something, but you can turn the page and decide to take a different path and take hold of your life and have a joyous future. And that's what I hoped in all seriousness for people to get out of this book. And I've received hundreds and hundreds of letters and emails and tweets and whatever else from people saying, I really relate to this. You know, I went through this and that in my life and it was a trauma and I got through it and you make me feel like I can turn the page and have a happy life. I mean, I have two wonderful kids and a great husband and, you know, I think that a challenged past is actually a richness of experience to draw upon. You know how you don't want to raise your kids. You know what you want to do differently. You know what makes you miserable and what would make you happy. So it's you can turn it into a positive and have a happy life.
How far were you from your house?
Not that far. Like a half mile, maybe. I mean, it was a golf course community in a little tract home area in a suburbia in Southern California. You know, it was all houses. There wasn't a store in sight. It was as safe as it could be, but it was more, I mean, and that's why I think she felt comfortable trying to control us in this way. She did not really think anything would happen to us, and she thought we would just walk along. But I had seen it so many times, I thought, you know, I'm I'm just not going to get played like that. There's a way to take control of the situation and turn it.
Were you on TV then?
I was. Oh, yeah. I joined the cast of Little House on the Prairie right after that. And that was a blast. That was a lot of fun. I mean, Michael Landon was a larger than life, you know, he was God and Santa Claus rolled into one. He really lit up a room in a way those kind of people, in a way you do, Imus, you know, it's like the same quality.
No. It always seemed like, I don't never know him, but excuse me, he always seemed to me like a nice guy.
He was. I mean, and he also, the interesting thing about him is he owned that show. You know, he wrote it, he produced it, he exec produced it. So he was very serious about being economical with everyone's time. You know, I mean, I had dinner with Melissa Gilbert recently, and we were saying, you showed up on the set, lines learned, clean, rested, ready to go, hit your mark, because he didn't fool around. Oh. And as a kid, it's interesting because it taught the kids on that show a really solid work ethic. And you don't read about the kids from Little House going to Promises and, you know, robbing a dry cleaners. They all turned out okay. Look at Jason Bateman. I mean, it's a bunch of hard workers because he taught us, you're serious about your work, and then you have the pride of a job well done at the end of the day, and then you party and have a great time.
Yeah, there wasn't any freaky stuff going on.
Not that I knew of. You know, I was 8 years old, so I'm sure there was plenty of freakiness going on all around me, but I was just a little kid, so I didn't know any better.
How about Dan Marino? Did you read about that?
I did. I did read about that. I thought it was shocking that a handsome professional athlete had a little something on the side. You never hear about that. It is shocking.
Man.
I mean, who would guess? I mean, he's so handsome. Women throwing themselves at him, and he succumbed to it. That never happens in pro sports.
We're talking with Melissa Francis, who... When are you and Lori on? 1 o'clock?
We're on at 1 o'clock. That's right. We have a lot of fun and get into much trouble, and then I'm on again at 5, Money, with Melissa Francis.
Well. What got you? Well, you told me before what got you interested in this. We won't go.
I love news. I love news.
Well, why do you have a cowboy hat with you?
I have a cowboy hat. This was given to me as a gift from the hat store in Houston. Fabulous. I went down there to take my show live on the road down to Houston. I love Texas. So they gave this to me, and it's beautiful. It's from the American Hat Company. I would put it on, but Teresa worked really hard on my hair this morning right after she finished your lovely hair. So I think she would have a heart attack downstairs if I actually put it on. But it's gorgeous, right?
No.
No? No.
First of all,
I had it like this, and you immediately barked at me that I don't know what I'm doing with my cowboy hat. And I think
first
right
of all,
that.
The only cowboy hat actually to wear.
Yes.
Is Resist All, or maybe a Stetson. Resist All and Stetson are the same company.
Yeah.
But nobody wears that hat. And that hat is like something you would pay 99 cents for at the drugstore. It's a horrible hat.
You know, I think it's so, I couldn't disagree more. I think it's so lovely. And in fact, when they gave it to me, I couldn't fit it on my giant head. And they were sweet enough to take it back, make a different one, send it to me. So I think it's a fabulous hat. But I appreciate your opinion. I don't know.
It's not a fun. Well, I'm just trying
it
to
is.
Tell you.
It's gorgeous.
I actually, yeah. If I put this hat on, I get people.
Yeah, that is nice. That is very handsome.
I get people who want to know. I got it at the Man's Hat Shop in Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Do they make women's hats? Or
yes, they do.
Okay.
They'll block a hat any way you want it. So.
They will. But will I look like a man in it if it's the man's hat store? No.
My wife wears hats all the time. She looks good. So.
Yeah.
Of course, she looks good in a gunny sack. But,
that's true.
You know. As he might as well talk about some financial stuff. Stuart Viney comes in once in a while. Do you like him?
Yeah, he's a great guy. You beat him up pretty rough, though.
No, I don't.
No?
He says the economy's
don't you call him, like, the lying limey or something? Or, no? Am I thinking
that's
of
not my
else?
Fault. That's, oh. That has nothing to do with me.
Just nothing. Reading okay. The script.
Exactly.
Is the economy getting better? He says it is.
I don't know, Dave. I mean, negative growth in GDP. The St. Louis Fed says this is the worst recovery we have ever had in the history of the world. I mean, as long as they've
really?
Been keeping economic data, there's the trend, there's the average. We're like off the chart in terms of growth of the economy since the recession. It's horrible. Ask the 22 million people out there who don't have enough work to pay the bills or aren't working at all. It's terrible out there. No, it's not. The economy is not good.
So I'm right about Stuart. He has no idea what he's talking about.
Well, I wouldn't say that. Maybe he's optimistic. I mean, he's a cheery guy. He could be trying to look at the bright side. Lou Dobbs thinks the economy is great. I happen to agree with the St. Louis Fed because they're economists who do math and they're looking at the numbers and they are not injecting any emotion into it. They're just looking at the numbers and they say, wow, GDP is horrible.
You like Lou Dobbs?
I love Lou Dobbs. No, no. Am I wrong in that? Are there things about Lou that you know that I don't?
Yeah, a lot of stuff.
We could just quietly talk about it here. No one's listening.
Do you think he's had any work done?
Lou Dobbs is so fantastically handsome. He comes out onto the set with Lori and I, and we just swoon. So whatever it is, it's working, baby.
You know, you are just selling me on it, but honest to God.
Huh? You're what not
are you
lying?
Liking? Oh, you care about the Super Bowl?
I love the Super Bowl. I'm a huge Niners fan. I have been a Niners fan all my life, growing up in California. I've been forced to root for the Tampa Bay Buccaneers because my husband is from Tampa, and I got to tell you, that's been painful, really agonizing the past couple. We went to one Super Bowl. It was back in the 1800s, and that was fun, but since then, it's been really tough.
So you think they'll win, then?
I think they will win.
Okay. So.
Yeah, we could lay some sort of wager or, you know, something. No, you don't want to do that. Okay.
I don't know.
No.
Well, you seem fine, so we like having you on.
Okay, I faked it. I made it through. It was only a couple minutes, so I could seem fine for this period of time. I'll go weep in the hallway now.
Are you on any kind of prescription medication?
No, not right now. I have a little blood pressure issue. My blood pressure is high, but I think that's normal.
Okay.
Ish. Yeah.
Get rid of that.
Do you have any medication? Are you sharing? Is that why you were asking?
No, if I had anything, I'd be taking it.
Okay.
Melissa Francis here. I'm still wearing program. Pretty good. She'll be on at 1 o'clock with a little tiny Lori Rothman, and then by herself at 5 on the Fox Business Network. It is now 11 minutes to the hour. I had to watch 11 seconds of this thing they have on CBS called The Talk Les Moonves' wife.
Mm-hmm.
She's cute. God.
That's like
seems
their
nice, but
their version of The View. Type
oh
of
my
thing. Yeah.
God.
Yeah, it's
Shoot
not
me.
Good.
It's pretty brutal.
That is bad, Warner.
I would rather go to a
Olive Garden
Taylor Swift concert and hold Rob on my shoulders.
Yeah, you could do it. That would be great.
By the way, I'm sick of her.
Bring a lighter, Rob.
I mean, she's fine. I'm sick of her records.
Bring two lighters.
Well, enough.
At least.
You know, I knew you were trouble when you were whatever.
Yeah,
so it's the number one pop song in America.
That's right.
And I think it's the number one country song.
Sure.
Is this a good spot, Rob? Can you see?
Let me take my shirt off.
Exactly.
You want to get my lighter out of my pocket?
Let's get some shirts.
I don't blame you for getting irritated.
But you're the guy who's defending John Travolta, who's grabbing the crotch of people, and you say, no, it's no big deal. Now a little kissing, and you know.
No, wait a minute. I wasn't defending John Travolta.
Totally defending John.
No, I just said we don't have any facts.
It's okay for John Travolta to put some guy's hand on his scrotum.
No.
That's okay. What do we care?
No, I didn't say that. You're misrepresenting what I said. What I said was we don't have any facts about John Travolta.
No, that's not. You were like, why do we care if it happened?
Why
do we care?
Well, why do we care?
There we go.
So now, okay, but that's the point.
We care about sexual assault, obviously.
Then why do we care if this guy tried to kiss Will Smith on the mouth? Not even on the mouth. It was on the cheek.
But I don't blame Will Smith. I don't blame him.
Well,
keep your hands off of me. I don't blame Will Smith.
But how about consistency in argument? I mean, isn't that the basis for any sound logical argument is consistency?
Why do you always try to paint me as some kind of wacko?
Not wacko, a half pervert, I would say,
what?
Too.
Wow.
A whacked out perv.
You're against a cheek kiss, but apparently a scrotum grab's okay
yeah,
by you.
All right. No, Don,
thank you. I'm your lips to God's ears, and of course, your radio audience now.
No, don't start weeping, Dollar Dwight.
Don't jinx me. You know what? I'm just thrilled to be able to have music back out. And with Warner Brothers, that's, you know.
I got to let you go.
You got to let me go.
Yes.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for nothing, I guess. But thanks for nothing,
you son of a bitch. You've been on for 10 minutes. What do you mean thanks for nothing?
Hey, wait a minute.
Play your record. John, thanks for nothing. You bastard. You ingrate.
You know what?
Let's do some business news here. Now, here with that is the Dave McDonald.
He's been playing his record ever since it came out. Is he out of his mind?
What, is he crazy? Thanks for nothing.
Oh,
you
my
son
God.
Of a bitch.
New York City doesn't even know what's going on. You're playing his record.
Man, oh, man.
Thanks for nothing.
Thanks for nothing.
That was great, man.
I'm
going
to murder him.
Dwight, who?
Jeez.
Because you know why?
Got some malware.
Because Smoke won over the weekend.
I know, your fat little goober boyfriend. NASCAR boyfriend. Fat little Tony Stewart won a race. Oh, good. Great.
So anyway.
Smoke won.
Smoke
this.
That's great.
So anyway, these hackers broke into computers back in 2007, and now...
Doesn't take much.
Yeah, go smoke.
Go smoke.
Yeah, that's smoke. It, baby. That's it, my weekend made, baby.
They pretty much got it fixed in just a few
people. And it was
people.
On Saturday, wasn't it?
Might be infected.
It was on Saturday, yes.
Saturday night. Saturday night. Yeah.
God.
What is wrong with you people?
Yeah, what awesome. Better time to have a NASCAR race like, than Saturday night? Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Hey, they're going around in a circle. Wow.
Oh, this is great. Yeah. How'd Dale Jr. do?
He finished 15th.
I'll be darned.
Yeah. It was a ton of wrecks, man. Ton of wrecks.
Ladies and gentlemen, Imus in the morning.
Well, big day tomorrow. And then we get the Super Bowl picks of Warner Wolf and Guns. Councilman. And I'm going to say Lupica, but Lupica will be on, but we don't care what he picks.
Oh, we don't?
No.
All right.
But we'll get Dagan's and yours and...
Right.
Rob and Tony and Lou Rufino, Benoit, and all that.
It'll be great.
Oh, man.
People setting their alarm clocks now.
I guess.
Yeah.
But big news, of course, one of the hosts of the pregame show, Dan Marino, former elite quarterback of all of them. He ranks up there in the top five all the time, doesn't he?
Sure. Maybe top three.
Top three?
Yeah. As far as records go, sir.
Boy, got a love child.
Yeah, he does.
Mm. Now, this has been going on. So the love child is 7 years old.
Right.
Is it a boy or a girl?
It's a girl.
Girl. And Mr. Marino has assumed all responsibility for the child and the mother. So, and the question is, you can make a moral judgment on his behavior, if you want. Well, my question is, he seems like a very nice guy and not a genius, but then who is?
Yeah.
Well, there's a lot of geniuses, actually, Amos.
Oh, good.
Start with Bob Dylan and Stephen Hawking.
Mm-hmm. Did they also talk to themselves?
Bob Dylan.
But who ratted him out?
All right.
What would be the point? And doesn't just, seem like a, he just doesn't seem like a bad guy. Who would drop the dime on him? I'm suggesting it was Boomer Esiason.
No.
John Madden.
And what about the timing?
Why now?
4 days before maybe the biggest audience the pregame show has ever had.
It's perfect. Perfect.
Yeah. Right, they'll have plenty of time to talk about it.
Well, of course, all these Super Bowl parties, you can't hear anything. You know, So, you know, the only people who hear the pregame shows are 38-year-old white men who live with their mom and are down in the basement with their plasma TV.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody else actually hears what's going on, do they, Dagan?
Fair point.
Can't hear the sound, so you
Fair point. That's why I watch it alone.
So you can just, where's Rollo?
I'm wandering around, but you, alone meaning no friends or family members come over.
Because you can't hear what's going on, right?
Right, exactly.
But what do you need to hear?
The commercials.
Right.
That and the commentary and them calling the game and everything.
All right. So, you know, it was a good guest, Melissa Francis.
She was good, yeah.
Indeed.
Smart.
I guess she's all right, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, she seems fine.
She doesn't look like she's medicated or taking a bunch of whatever people take to level out now.
Mm-hmm.
To Zoloft, whatever that means. I don't know what.
Right. He says, staring at a man dressed up as Little Richard, another man dressed up as Larry King.
But try to get that out of your mind, that opening page of her book. I mean,
Ted Bundy looked fine, too.
Huh?
Ted Bundy looked fine, too.
Yes, Ted Bundy did look fine. Little Richard?
Mighty fine. That was the problem for all those women.
So you never can tell.
No, Little Richard, you can't.
Shut up.
Are we suggesting now that Melissa Francis is on the precipice of murdering a bunch of people?
Or already has.
You're the one who said you wouldn't be surprised she had body parts in her freezer.
Yeah.
Actually, I wouldn't be surprised if you told me.
Right.
I mean, let's start naming people.
Oh, good.
And just off the top of your people we all know.
Stuart Varney.
Oh,
no question. Gagball, leather mask.
Yeah.
Todd, Mrs. Mm-hmm. Varney, of course, absolutely.
John LeBoutelier.
Get the gimp.
Dagan McDowell.
John LeBoutelier.
John LeBoutelier. Oh, yeah. Come on, man.
Korean boys. Sucking the laces off of Asian boys.
Oh, come on.
He hasn't been on in like a year.
Frank Lutz.
Frank Lutz.
Oh, stop. That's too
man,
easy.
I mean, you're talking about get your freak on.
LeBoutelier.
Poor LeBoutelier. He's driving off the LIE.
He's probably
down.
Reading over some big document right now.
Sitting
onto the IMAD right now.
Frank
now.
Lutz.
Oh, God.
Oh, man, that's a three-ring circus there.
Yeah.
He told me one time he won't come on the program anymore because...
Oh, I wonder why.
We're talking about a dead piece of lettuce he's got on his head. That boy, he says he goes to Vegas a lot, knows everybody in Vegas.
Sure.
He says he likes to people watch.
Mm.
Yeah.
So you're walking through the Bellagio or wherever... And there's Frank sitting there.
Yeah. Okay, that one. I'm a tourist.
Oh, man, that's really great. What if I can get her to come up to the room? Oh, man. Imagine there's Susie Hamilton or some other hooker out there.
Some other, yeah.
Did I say $600 an hour? Wrong make it $1,600.
Yeah. And it's Frank Luntz.
This is not 434. I'm looking for 434. Wrong room. Sorry.
Well, let's do this. Oh, God. See what I mean?
It always comes back. Comes
there's
back
just
to
no
Frank.
One. No one you can name it. You know it's just not some flat out what? Swinging from the chandeliers juiced up freak.
Right. Yeah. Everybody is.
So, Connell seems pretty.
No,
he's
up to three kids and a
right.
Yeah,
cute wife and all
he's
that.
He's got that Donna Reed lifestyle going on.
Yeah. Those are the ones you got to be most afraid of.
The trouble is, he's probably dressed up
good
like
cover.
Donna Reed at home.
All right, time for the news.
Hello.
Here with that is Donna Reed. Good morning, Donna.
Good morning, I'm man. Some breaking news overseas this morning. Syria and Iran now threatening to retaliate against Israel for these airstrikes that we've reported on this morning. Israel reported to have carried out airstrikes inside of Syria. This is a story that could develop throughout the day. There's been serious flooding developing in the northeast, in particular the D.C. area this morning. We have some pictures of that we'll show on the Fox Business Network, where fire and rescue crews have been busy at several locations helping stranded drivers in and around Washington, D.C. This after tornadoes and other strong storms ripped through the southeast. Here's a woman who heard the wind picked up and made the mistake of opening the door of her trailer.
It just had me slinging on that door. And when I get inside, it tossed me straight into the other bedroom where the little bathroom is, and I stool under there for a while, and then it just seemed like it was never going over.
What a mess in many states across the southeast.
You know, here's something for you to think about.
Yeah.
No matter who you are, where you are.
Right.
No matter where you go or what you're doing,
mm-hmm.
Somebody like Frank Luntz is watching you. Are you going into the Subway sandwich shop or the mall or I don't care what you're doing.
Yeah.
Getting out of the limo, getting into the taxi, whatever you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
Some freak is
conducting a focus group.
Is watching you.
Right.
Oh, man, I'm going to tell you now.
That guy behind the tinted windows in the limo, he's watching you.
Yeah.
Right along these lines, following up on a story we talked about a few months back, the country music star Randy Travis, he'll be making an appearance at court in Texas. Prosecutors say he's expected to plead guilty to driving while intoxicated. Remember the drunken driving case began last summer.
Well, Randy's straightening himself out now.
He was accused of crashing his car while driving naked.
Randy Travis is a great guy.
It happens.
And he's a good man.
Speaking of freaks.
Well.
And Randy has some problems, but I love him to death. He's a friend of mine.
Right.
And, you know, we all, but he's fine now. He and Kyle are doing another album.
Right.
and one of the great voices in country music. He's going to behave himself now.
Just give you one more story, Iman, as the news cooperates with our conversation this morning. New Jersey Senator Robert Menendez, he's denying allegations of hiring underage prostitutes in the Dominican Republic. The office of one of his big political donors in Florida.
What age were they?
Was raided yesterday by federal agents. They're reported by this website, The Daily Caller, believed to be teenage prostitutes in the Dominican.
He is such an unctuous creep.
Right.
That you want everything to be true about him.
We'll see.
14 after the hour, let's do some business news. And here with that is Dagan McDowell. What's going on, Dagan?
Good morning. So Dow futures have turned higher, up by 3 points right now. Bottom of the last hour, we got several pieces of news on the economy. Jobless claims for the most recent week jumped 38,000. Don't want to see that. But for December, we got personal spending and income. Spending came in roughly kind of right in line with expectations. But listen to this. Personal income in December jumped 2.6%. That was the biggest monthly increase in 8 years. What companies were doing were paying out dividends and bonuses early to avoid higher taxes in the new year. But again, the consumer holding up the economy right now.
I'm very happy to hear that. Quarter after the hour here on the IMUS Sunday Morning Program. Warner probably has some sports. He wants to do that. Coming up tomorrow, What is today? Friday? Tomorrow's Friday? Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow is, yeah.
Right.
I wonder who's going to be on tomorrow. Do you know, Bernard?
Mike Lupica.
Yeah.
All right.
Today's the last day of January, boss.